हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम बैक वंस अगेन. माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद करंट अफेयर्स एंड दिस वुड बी योर थर्ड क्लास फॉर द करंट अफेयर्स एंड दिस वुड बी अ डेली करंट अफेयर्स बेस्ड क्लासेस. सो वी आर गोइंग टू कवर विद द करंट अफेयर्स, टुडेज करंट अफेयर्स, दैट इज 19th of December 2020. ऑल राइट, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद the current affairs, today's current affairs, and I am basically covering or I am basically taking the reference of the Hindu newspaper, right? Apart from that, I am also taking the some news from the Indian Express also. All right, so let's begin with the news. Okay, so the today's news is basically the front news which is coming out is the Human Freedom Index 2020. All right, so first of all, this Human Freedom Index, which was basically, you know, taking the countries throughout the world. So it is basically the countries throughout the world, out of which the India achieved the rank of 111, right? Out of 162 countries. So it is a nationwide ranking. It is a nationwide ranking of the freedom. Freedom per se is civil freedom, economic freedom, personal freedom, right? So it is basically having various components in it. So it basically considered as one of the best index when you compare the freedom that is available in the countries to the citizens of the country. Okay, the civil freedom, economic freedom, and the personal freedom, which was considered as a three part or three ingredient of the Human Freedom Index, and it basically ranked India as a 94th position in 2019, but the India's position in 2020 has slipped to 111th spot out of 162 countries. So you can say here that India scored the marks, or roughly the score of India is basically 6.30 out of 10, right? It is based on the personal freedom. It is based on the personal freedom. Then on the economic freedom front, the India achieved 6.51 out of 10. Right, this is a score which basically is scored by the India, and country's overall human freedom was achieved at 6.43 out of 10. So these are basically the freedoms which basically consist of civil, economic, and personal freedom, and overall we have the Human Freedom Index. All right, so you must understand these words. When I say the personal freedom, the personal freedom means it is not absolute personal freedom. It is subjected to those restrictions which are decided or which are made by the constitution of our country. Okay, the constitution in the case of India is supreme. There is no other body which is supreme than the constitution of India. So constitution prescribes certain limitations on the freedom, but we need to understand that those basic freedoms which are necessitated for human development, for cherishing the basic human rights, right? We are talking about those basic freedoms, right? For example, if I say whether I have the personal freedom of investing somewhere, whether I have the personal freedom of going and moving and settling somewhere, right? So these freedoms are available in the Indian context also. The economic freedom, you must understand, to establish a particular, you know, industries, to set up a particular industries, right? So in the economic front, right, that freedom is also available to India, but there are still various lacunas, right? For example, we have the over regulations in the economic field, right? So there are some problems with the regulatory side. There are some problems with, say, investment side. There are some problems with, say, for example, from the government side, which does not provide single window clearance for all the projects. Isn't just a lot of problems are there. The government has to reform all those things in order to make the India as a progressive nation in terms of the human freedom index. Okay, for example, your fundamental rights are there. These fundamental rights are very much essential for the overall development of the humans. Okay, in the similar way, the human freedoms are also very essential for the development of human. Without human freedom, you cannot achieve achieve of your fundamental goals. All right, this year the New Zealand, Switzerland, Hong Kong bagged the first three spots. Okay, so these are the three countries which are at the top three positions of Human Freedom Index. The United States and United Kingdoms, right, both are at tied at the 17th spot in the index. Okay, the Syria, which ranked the last, because the Syria is basically inflicted because of the wars, or it is because of some sort of, you know, ISIS related, war related phenomena. So because of that, it is considered as a least preferred country in terms of the Human Freedom Index. Okay, when you compare regionally, so China is at 129th rank, Bangladesh is 139th rank, and Pakistan is 140th rank. So you can say that India's position is much better than its neighbors. India is currently at 111th spot, okay, but the China is 129th spot, Bangladesh is 139th spot, and Pakistan is 140th spot. The index was published by American think tank that was, or that is called Cato Institute and Fraser Institutes, right, in the Canada. So it was basically published by the cooperation of these two institutes. Okay, the one is basically American think tank, that is Cato Institute, and the second is basically the Fraser Institute in the Canada. Okay, now regarding authoring of this report, the Fred McMahon and Ivan Vanquez are the authors of this report, are the authors of these reports. Okay, it take around 76 indicators of personal, civil, and economic freedoms to rank 162 countries in the world. All right, so these 76 indicators are taken into account while calculating this Human Freedom Index, right? All right, the institutes noted that the world have seen a notable decline in the personal freedom since 2008. Okay, so it is general statement that throughout the world, this human freedom has reduced to the lower level, because there are a lot of conflict that is going on. For example, in the world, there are problems like refugee problems, the climate change is going on, the countries have become more violent, more extremist ideology have been there. Okay, even in the countries, rightist parties, for example, because of the policies of the Donald Trump, even some of the natives of the USA is also not happy with those policy, even in India also, right? So a lot of problems are there where the freedom of the individual have been snatched. For example, especially the minorities people and the lower class people, for example, the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe people are also felt cheated out of the government policies, right? So all such things has led to the decline of the freedom which is available to the normal citizens of this country. Okay, now this is the chart basically which shows you the top and bottom countries in terms of the Human Freedom Index. So as I told you, the New Zealand backs the top position, that is the score is 8.87 out of 10. Switzerland second spot, that is 8.82 out of 10. Hong Kong third spot, that is 8.74. All right, Denmark fourth spot, 8.73, and Australia, that is 8.68. All right, and these are basically the last five countries in the Human Freedom Index. You can see here the Iran 158th position, Yemen Republic is basically 159th position, Venezuela 160 position, Sudan 161 position, and Syria 162 position. Okay, so Syria is basically at the lowest ranking in terms of the Human Freedom Index, and New Zealand is at the top of Human Freedom Index. Cumulative score of the New Zealand is 8.87 out of 10, and the cumulative score of the Syria is just 3.97, right, in 2020. All right, now let's begin with the new news. Okay, that is the great conjunction. So let's understand what was the news first of all. So first of all, it is almost 400 years ago, or you can say that nearly after 400 years, the Saturn and the Jupiter will be brought closest in the night sky by the astronomical event that is called Great Conjunction, and popularly known as Christmas Star. So you must understand that event was happened around 400 years ago. So that is after 400 years, you know, down the span of the line, the Saturn and the Jupiter, these two planets, you know, brought closest in the night sky by an astronomical event. That is called, or that phenomena is called basically great conjunction of Saturn and the Jupiter. So you must understand, this is only associated with the Saturn and the Jupiter, not all the planets. And it is because of an astronomical event, right? Which has led to the closest association of these two planets, right? Let's understand this news further. So on December 21st, almost all viewers across the world will be able to see the two gas giants. So you must understand why we call these gas giants. These are gas giants because these are outer planets, or these are called Jovian planets. So you have the Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars. These four planets are considered as inner planets, or they are also called terrestrial planets or Earth-like planets. Okay. But the outer planets, that is after Mars, so Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, then Jupiter, Saturn, these planets are considered as a Jovian planets. That means they are gas giant with them. They don't have the solid surface, rather than they are basically the gaseous substances. They are basically the gaseous substances. So now all viewers throughout the world able to see these gas giants, which were millions of the kilometers away, very close to the each other, right? And they will still be hundreds of the millions of the miles apart in the space. Okay, so you must understand, this astronomical phenomena has led to the viewing of these two gas giants very close to each other. But you must understand, they still are millions of the kilometers away from each other. Now this conjunction which is there between Saturn and Jupiter, now you must understand that is not unique to that Saturn and the Jupiter itself, but it is an event, right, which is where the planets or the asteroids appear very close in the sky when you view from the Earth. Otherwise they are still further away from the Earth, or from each other itself, right? So it's an event which looks like as if they are closer to them. Now the astronomers use the word great, right, for the conjunction of the Jupiter and the Saturn, because the size of the planets are very vast. So they use this conjunction as a great conjunction. Otherwise, it is a conjunction which is basically an event which looks like as if the two planets are closer enough to each other. All right. Now, this general phenomena that we study as a conjunction is generally happens in around 20 to 30 years. So you can say around 20 years, this phenomena occurs, right? Because now, every time each of the planets take to the orbit around the sun, because they are the planets which basically revolve around the sun, or so they rotate on their axis, and they basically revolve in the orbit around the sun. So they basically take the time around 20 years. Jupiter takes around 12 years to complete one revolution around the sun, and Saturn take around 30 years to revolve around the sun. So in the meanwhile, say 12 years when they rotate, and 30 years when the Saturn take 30 years to revolve around the sun, roughly around 20 years down the line, their orbits appear to be closer to each other, right? Their orbits appear to the closer to the each other because of this phenomena. And this year, however, the event is rare because of the planets will come to the closest to each other in nearly four centuries. All right. So these are, you know, some of the feature which basically led to, or some of the events which basically led to, the phenomena which is also called the Great Conjunction. Okay. Let's understand gas-safe pigs, jo hamare paas hote hain, suar jisko bolte hain, wahi hai. Gas-safe pigs. Okay. Now, the news is flashing in our newspaper that U.S. Food and Drug Administration, this is an agency which basically regulate the drugs and the food in basically USA. So the agency, which is called U.S. Food and Drug Administration, approved the first of its kind intentional genomic alteration in the line of domestic pigs, preferred to be called gal-safe pigs. So they have introduced something which is called basically the genomic alterations, right? So certain alterations have been done. For example, you have genetically modified, right? Genetically modified varieties. For example, you have genetically modified brinjal, genetically modified crops, isn't it? Like that, this genomic alterations also infused in the domestic pigs also, right? For example, why they have using this genomic alterations in the pig? Obviously, there may be the reasons of the food, there may be reasons of the medical use of such pigs, all right? So to have some sort of a scientific discovery, scientific research, so they have used this genomic alterations in the pig also. I hope it is clear. So when you make some genetic modifications or genetic modulations or modifications in the genes of a parent, you know, parent varieties, either of the crops or the animals, this whole process is called basically genetic manipulation or alteration. Now, let's understand, genetically modified pigs have been approved for the food, right? Why they have used the genetically modified? That may be the reason. For example, the pig industry, for example, this meat rearing industries, right, or meat industries for the pigs, especially with respect to the pigs, people preferred the pig meat also. Okay, so the pig basically used for the food. If this genomic alterations has led to, for example, the speedening the process of the fattening of the pigs, okay, if the pigs, you know, the growth has enhanced because of the genetic modification, if the pig meat has become more, you know, nutrient enough or more in terms of the nutrients, minerals, and etc. and so forth, so that will be useful for your food also. So that is why these genomic modifications have been done, right? So that these genes, which are more favorable to the human, health, can also be put into the body of your pig, right? So also a medical use in the US, right? So it draws a mixed reactions. Why we are using these pigs basically for genomic alterations, right? The reason behind that, for the food or basically for the medical use. So it has led to, the hue cry basically in the market, and it also says, also goes the mixed reactions from the different segments of the people. Now, the pigs are the only second GM animal to be approved for the food after GM salmon. Salmon is a variety of your basically fish. So it was basically approved by the US Food and Drugs Administration. After that, this GM pig was approved by the US Food and Drug Administration for feeding purpose. Okay, this US FDA this week approved the GM pigs, which have been engineered to eliminate alpha zal, a sugar bound in the pigs that can cause allergic reactions. All right. So as I told you, more preferably genes will be put in the genomic alterations in the pigs. So this gene, which is called basically alpha zal, which has some negative implications on the people who eat that meat. For example, in some people, they cause allergic reactions. Now, to remove this allergic reactions, they have to eliminate through this engineering process this alpha gene. So through genomic alterations, they would have easily done that. So they have done to remove this alpha gene so that this allergic reactions can be removed. Now, FDA further says that it is the first time it has approved the GM animal for the human food and medical use. All right. So the first time they have basically used this GM pigs for medical use also. FDA also says that it is determined that food from the GM pigs known as GalSafe is safe for general population to eat. All right. So it is basically the name they have made is GalSafe pigs. That means the safe for general population to eat. Right, and suggested that the meat might be sold by the mail order also. So it is up to, you know, the market marketing, this can be marketed through the mail order also. All right, then R cluster. Let's understand this R cluster also. So R cluster, R means here the Reliance. R means here the Reliance. Okay, so what is this R cluster? So there is, you know, the two way, the collaboration that was basically, you know, has led to the great emphasis. For example, in India, the Reliance Industries and the British Petroleum from Britain have announced the start of gas production from our cluster, that is Reliance cluster, the deepest offshore gas field in the Asia. Okay, so they have started the gas production from the R cluster, right, that are considered to be the deepest offshore field in the Asia. Now, the field which is called R cluster is about 60 kilometers from the existing KG basin. KG basin means Krishna Godavari. So KG basin means Krishna Godavari, D6 control and riser platform of the Kakinada coast, right? Which comprise a subsea production system tied back to CRP via subsea pipeline. All right. So you must understand existing KG basin, which is also known as the Krishna Godavari basin. Nearby the Krishna Godavari basin, they have found this R cluster, which is also rich in terms of the gas exploration. The gas production has already started. The gas production, which is basically started by the Reliance Industries from India, as well as the British Petroleum, which both have collaborated to extract the gases from the R cluster, and they have been tied right through a subsea pipeline to transport this gas to the nearest refineries, right, or to the nearest plant. Now, the field, which is the first three deep water gas projects, is KGD6 block, jointly dubbed up by Reliance Industries Limited and British Petroleum to come on stream. Okay, so this basically the area or this field basically was jointly developed by these two conglomerates. Okay, now Reliance Industries Limited have been participating in interest of around 66% in KGD6 block, and British Petroleum have been participating around 33% in this block. So roughly you can say two-thirds of the cooperation came from the Reliance Industries, and one-third of the investment came from the British Petroleum in this KGD6 block, which is lying nearby, you know, your Krishna Godavari block or Krishna Godavari basin off the coast of Kakinada coast, right? All right. Then SolarWinds hack. Next news is SolarWinds hack. What is this SolarWinds hack? It is a basically cyber attack. So it is nothing like SolarWind, right? But you must understand the name, it is just a name for a cyber attack, right? Which is recently discovered in the United States, okay? So always, you know, try not to go all along the name itself. So it is nothing with the solar wind, but it is a cyber attack which was discovered in the United States, right? Now, this has emerged as one of the biggest ever target against the US government, right? So it is basically the targeted against the US government and its agencies and several other private agencies also. Now, it can be a global cyber attack also, because lot of other, you know, institutions are also integrated with those institutions also. Now, the question is coming that why this SolarWinds attack have been there in the USA, or why so many cyber attacks have been there in the USA and its companies, why they have been attacked so frequently. Okay, now the reason is that this is being so called the supply chain attack. Okay, now what is happening is, if you directly attack the federal government, right, you must understand the implications of such direct attack. And the second option is, you can instead of directly attacking on the federal government, you can basically attack a third party vendor. You are getting my point? You attack the third party vendor which basically supplies the software to them. Okay, if you attack the third party vendor which supply the software to them, you can easily put your cyber or some sort of a virus in the software, so that they can easily get manipulated even in your client position also. So instead of directly attacking on the government or private organizations, they started attacking on the third party vendor which basically supplies software to them. So this could be a one reason why this ongoing hike in the basically cyber attacks on the USA. Right. In this case, the target was an IT management software called Orion. You might have heard about this Orion, which is basically a Texas-based company, that is SolarWinds. All right. So the attack was basically, you know, on the IT management software that is called Orion. Now, this Orion have been dominant software from SolarWinds with clients which include around 33,000 companies. The SolarWinds says that 18,000 of its clients have been impacted. You must understand this Orion, which provide the software to the, to its clients. Now, if this Orion have been infected because of this cyber attack, what will happen? Obviously, the clients will be affected. So you see here, around 33,000 companies, basically, integrated with this Orion. Now, this Orion itself says that around 18,000 of its clients have been affected because of this SolarWinds attack. Now, how this this basically attack have been there? You see here, the hackers gained access to the victims via Trojanite updates to the SolarWinds. So it is a Trojan software which basically, a Trojan virus which basically, move through some software. This software, once you click them, it will be basically, captured your system and ultimately infect the whole system. So the IT monitoring and the management software, which was found that it was basically a via Trojanite updates, which basically led to this attack, which is also called SolarWinds hack. Okay, once installed, this malware or this software or this Trojanware gave a backdoor entry to the hackers. That means you understand, once you click the software, it will automatically install. And this, after installation, it will give you a backdoor entry. So then easily you can enter into the system and you can basically easily, take out some of the crucial files from the system. Just like a thief. So it is just like, the thieves which are not seen to the public. So it is just through this Trojanware, malware, right? It is just in the form of programs, just in the form of softwares. You basically put them in the system. Once they install, they will give you a backdoor entry. Through the backdoor entry, you can enter into the system and you can steal whatever the system, whatever the crucial information you want to steal. All right. So this is the news in the today's newspaper. Okay. Then E20 fuel. Okay. So first, understand the news, then we'll go to what is E20 fuel. So first of all, the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways have published a draft notification, okay, that is right, that is seeking a comments from the public for adoption of E20 fuel as an automated fuel for adoption of mass emission standard for this fuel. All right. So through the notification, the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways, right, has basically invited the public to comment, right, for adoption of E20 fuel as a automotive fuel, right, that will be used in the vehicles, right, for the adoption of mass emission standard for this fuel. Right. Now, what is this E20 fuel? The E20 fuel is basically a blend of 20% ethanol with gasoline. Okay, so it is basically a blend of 20% ethanol with the gasoline, which is basically as a fuel which can also be used as an alternative to what we use generally. Okay, the notification facilitates the development of E2 compliant vehicles, E20 compliant vehicles, because right now you don't have the E20 compliant vehicles. So if you want to push that E20 fuels in the vehicles, you need to change, right, certain emission related, parameters in the vehicles, so that this E20 fuels can also be burned in the vehicles also. So to produce this E20 compliant vehicles, certain changes has to be made in the vehicles also. It will also help in reduction of the emissions of the carbon dioxide, hydrocarbons, because the normal exhaust from burning of the fuels is basically a lot of greenhouse gases like nitrous oxide, methane, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, right? So when you burn or when you use this E20 fuel, definitely it will basically reduce the emissions that are in the form of carbon dioxide and hydrocarbons. And it will also help you to reduce the oil import bill, because you are ultimately blending 20% of ethanol with a gasoline, and it will ultimately, right, when it will reduce the oil import bill, ultimately it will also give you a lot of savings in terms of foreign exchange, because 80% of our crude oil requirement have been met through the import. 80% around 81 or 83% of your crude oil requirement have been made through the imports. So if you make such alternative arrangement, obviously your import requirement for the crude oil also will decrease. And moreover, it will also beneficial in terms of the saving of foreign exchange. And also it will boost you your energy security because every time the country is dependent on the exporters which export this crude oil. So that makes the India basically the energy secure in terms of such fuels. Okay. Now, the compatibility of the vehicle to the percentage of the ethanol in the blend of the ethanol and the gasoline shall be defined by the vehicle manufacturer. Okay. And the same shall be displayed on the vehicle by putting in early visible sticker. So that thing is very simple. So this point will basically convey to you the point that is that whatever the compatibility of the vehicle is there with respect to this E20 fuel, that shall be defined by the vehicle manufacturer. That is quite common because a lot of changes has to be made in the vehicles in order to make them E20 compliant vehicle. And the same changes has to be displayed on the vehicle by putting them, on the windshield, say some sticker, which will show you that it is E20 compliant vehicle. Okay. Then the next is draft national rail plan. Okay. Now, this draft national rail plan was drafted by basically, by the Indian Railways, right? So Indian Railways basically issued this draft national plan. All right. So let's understand. Let's understand this draft national plan. Okay. What was there? Okay. So ultimate objective of this plan is to create a capacity ahead of demand by 2030, because you must understand the demand for the railway connectivity is going to be increased, right? By 2030. So this plan basically have the objective of enhancement of such, capacity in terms of catering the demand, right? In terms of say, number of trains, better connectivities, right? Better facilities, better freight connectivities, right? So all sort of things has already taken into account while making this draft national rail plan, right? So to anticipate those needs, this draft national plan was basically prepared by the Indian national by the Indian Railways. Now, which in turn would cater to the growth in demand right up to 2050. So that will basically cater the growth which has come out even after 2030 up to 2050, and it also increased the modal share of the railways from currently 27% currently to 45% in the freight by 2030. So what is this modal share of the railways? So out of 100%, the railway share in the freight means the goods and goods basically that transported by the railway. So that freight, the share of the railways is currently 27%. Now, this draft national plan is basically aiming to increase this modal share of the railways in terms of the freight from 27% to 45% by 2030 itself. It also aims to reduce the transit time of the freight subsequently by increasing average speed of the freight trains from 22 kilometers per hour to 50 kilometers per hour. Because you must understand the freight trains or the good trains, freight means good trains, which basically, transport the good items. Now, these good trains generally do not move with the speed just like a passenger trains, right? They have the average speed of around 22 kilometers per hour also, right? Now, these trains used to stop a lot of locations, even out of locations also, because the first preferences is given to the passenger trains rather than these goods trains. Okay. So in order to increase their average speed from 22 kilometers per hour to 50 kilometers per hour, right? This also aimed via this plan. Now, a three dedicated freight corridors का मतलब होता है, these corridors will only be used by the goods train or by the freight trains. Okay. They generally will not be used by the passenger trains. So dedicatedly, you will make, a separate tracks. These tracks would only be used by the goods train. So these three dedicated freight corridors, which are namely called as East Coast, East West, and North South, which are identified along with timelines, right? The survey has already underway. So these dedicated corridors will be made, and this will ensure that the goods train will move with a greater speed. Just like, unlike in the present context when that the goods train is moving ahead, the goods train has to stop somewhere and the passenger train has to pass, because the more preferences is given to the passenger train. When you have the dedicated freight corridor, there is no need to stop them. They can continue and your passenger train also can be continued. So these three dedicated corridor, east coast, west, east, west, and north south corridor, these three surveys already underway. Okay. Now, to assess this locomotive requirement to meet to an objective of 100% electrification, okay, by December 2030 is also increasing the traffic right up to 2030 and beyond up to 2050. Okay, so you must understand when the demand will increase for the railways, obviously you need the better locomotive also, and your demand for the locomotives also will increase. And also the government has the objective of 100% electrification of all railways, because in few stretches you have still, you know, the locomotives which are run on the diesel, right? A few stretches in India, right? Now, to make all stretches, right, the diesel free, you have to electrify them. So once you need to electrify them, you need to have the better locomotives which should be available on that dam, and you need to have the better connectivity also. So ultimately the demand for them will also be increased. Now, several new high speed rail corridors, just like in Mumbai to Ahmedabad, a bullet train project has already been started. Okay, now several new high speed rail corridors also been identified. These are not bullet train projects, but several high speed projects which should be, you know, around 200 kilometers per hour the trains will be moving on these tracks. For example, Delhi-Varanasi high speed railway already undergo. Okay, just like a bullet train project between Ahmedabad and Mumbai, this Delhi and Varanasi high speed train project is already undergo, right? Already feasibility study already undergone in this, you know, projects. All right. Next, World Minorities Rights Day. Okay, minority, aap sabko pata hai. Minorities are those people which are numerically short in the number, numerically. Okay, when you say, for example, in the India, you have 83% of the population, or roughly you say 79 or 80% of the population belongs to Hindu. Okay, roughly you say 2% or 2.2% population belongs to the Christianity. 1.3 or 1.4% belongs to the Sikhism and other Buddhism also. Okay, so roughly you can say 84% of the population profess, you know, the Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, and associated religion. But the you say basically the Islam consists of around say 13% or 14% of the population of present India. Now this Islam, Buddhism, Jainism, right, Sikhism, they are considered as a minority because we are considering as their number. So that is how the concept called minority comes out. So we consider basically in terms of their numeric number. Okay, this National Commission for the Minority celebrated the World Minority Days. Okay, this National Commission for the Minority basically is a statutory body. It is not a constitutional body because it has been made by the statute of the parliament. Statute ka matlab hota hai by the law which is passed in the parliament, then only this body was established. Constitutional body ka matlab hota hai jisko constitution ne banaya hota hai, jaise National Commission for the Scheduled Caste, National Commission for the Scheduled Tribe, these are constitutional bodies. But the National Commission for the Minority, it is not a constitutional body because original constitution does not provide the institution of National Commission for the Minority. It is only after the parliament has made this body by the statute or by the act passed in the parliament. All right. Now, United Nations on December 18, 1992 adopted and broadcast the statement on individuals' rights belongs to religious and linguistic, national or ethnic minority. Now, two types of minority have been recognized by the Constitution of India that you already know. One is called your numeric minority, or you say basically, it is based on basically on the two parameters. When you say linguistic minority, linguistic ka matlab hota hai, the speakers of those particular language is very few. Okay, and religious based minority means the speakers, the religious based minority means the people who basically profess a particular religion is also numerically, you know, few, numerically lower. So in terms of the religious practices and in terms of the speaking of particular language, there are two types of minority. One is called basically your religious minority. Another is called basically your linguistic minority. There is one more minority that is called ethnic minority. So it's based on the ethnicity. Okay. So based on the ethnicity, there is another set of minorities. So all three minorities are there. In India, we have the constitution provide basically the linguistic and the religious minorities, because ethnically we are all similar. Ethnically, we are all similar. All right. So this, the same year, the National Commission for the Minority was set up by the government of India. So in 1992, the protection of, or 1992, the parliament has passed, a law or is the statute, and that has led to the establishment of the National Commission for the Minority. Now, the Ministry of Minority Affairs was established in 2016. It was carved out of the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. Initially, there was only one ministry, that was Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, right? Now, the need was felt in 2006 that a separate ministry should be set up to safeguard the rights which is given to the minorities, right? In 2006, the separate ministry was set up, and it was basically carved out from the existing ministry, that is called Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. And in 2016, the separate Ministry of Minority Affairs was basically, enacted or formulated. The day celebrated by the National Commission for the Minority, what we have is basically on the establishment day, okay? That is 18th of the December, okay? Because United Nations on that day adopted and broadcast the statement on individuals' right. You're getting my point? So that is the reason we have basically, passed this, we have set up this institution, which is called the National Commission for the Minority. And this day on which the United Nations basically adopted and broadcast the statement of individuals' right, which belongs to the religious minority, linguistic minority, or ethnic minority, the day was chosen to celebrate as a World Minority Day. Even that day was chosen in India also. Okay, so which the India basically celebrate the focusing on the religious harmony, respect, and better understanding of all minority communities which are residing in India. Okay, let's say the last point, the Constitution of India provides the equal rights for all the citizens and safeguarding the rights of the linguistic, right, ethnic, cultural, and religious minority. So that I have already discussed you that the Indian Constitution provided equal rights, right? Whether you are majority or minority, so you have even itself certain rights or certain fundamental rights which are given to the religious minorities. For example, Article 25 to 28, the Constitution of India provide the fundamental rights to the minorities, fundamental rights to the minority. So that means certain provisions in our Constitution also safeguard the rights of the minority, whether they are, the linguistic minority or ethnic minority, cultural minority or religious minority. Now, they also have the provisions of economically and socially disadvantaged people, right, which belongs to, the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. But that is altogether a different task, because there is separate commission for that. That is National Commission for the Scheduled Caste and National Commission for the Scheduled Tribe. So I hope it is clear. So why we celebrate this World Minority Day? Because on that day, the United Nations has basically adopted and broadcast a statement which state that the individual's rights belong to the religious minorities are important throughout the world. Okay, next is National Conference of Tuberculosis and the Chest Disease. Okay, that was basically a national conference. Okay, so what was the news? Dr. Harshvardhan, the Union Minister for the Health and Family Welfare, addressed the Platinum Jubilee of National Conference for Tuberculosis and the Chest Disease. Okay. So during that conference, the Harshvardhan basically addressed, this conference. So you see here, the Tuberculosis Association of India, which is basically, the oldest and the largest voluntary organizations, okay, have its affiliated throughout the country. So this Tuberculosis Association of India, which was basically set up in 1939, right, as a registered society, by incorporating basically two funds, or by mixing of these two funds, the two funds name as King Emperor's Anti-Tuberculosis Fund and King George Thanksgiving Anti-Tuberculosis Fund. So, right. So when you merge them in 1939, a separate registered society was formed that is called Tuberculosis Association of India. This conference was basically organized on behalf of this Tuberculosis Association of India. Okay, since 1939 itself, the association, which is also called the Tuberculosis Association of India, which is a registered society, right, after amalgamation of the King's Emperor's Anti-Tuberculosis Fund and King George Thanksgiving Anti-Tuberculosis Fund, has organizing the National Conference on the Tuberculosis. All right. So this conference, which is basically organized by the Tuberculosis Association of India, is organized by basically this Tuberculosis Association of India, is basically, you know, focusing on the containing of the tuberculosis and chest diseases, which is basically, you know, related to the tuberculosis related phenomena. Okay. It is an annual conference where around 500 delegates from all over the India assemble and exchange the views on the delegates on the tuberculosis. All right. So I hope it is understand. It is clear. So this National Conference of Tuberculosis and the Chest Disease, basically organized by Tuberculosis Association of India. The Tuberculosis Association of India is basically an registered society, which is the largest voluntary organizations which have affiliated throughout the country, and which is formulated in 1939 by amalgamation or by mixing of two funds. The fund is called King Emperor's Anti-Tuberculosis Fund and King George Thanksgiving Anti-Tuberculosis Fund. So in the preliminary examination, you can they can ask you the questions like the Tuberculosis Association of India is a statutory body, is a constitution body, or it's set up by the government of India, or it's an amalgamation of these funds. So all you have to remember this data also. Okay, next is DRDO system. So let's understand this DRDO system. Raksha Mantri Rajnath Singh. So Defense Minister Rajnath Singh handed over three indigenously developed the Defense Research and Development Organization systems to the Army. Okay, so this is DRDO systems to the Army, Navy, and Air Force at the functions held in DRDO Bhavan. Okay, so what is that which the news is talking all about, right? What is this indigenously developed the DRDO systems, right, is all about? So let's understand this one. So Rajnath Singh, who is basically a defense minister of the Raksha Mantri, right, handed over the Indian Maritime Situational Awareness System. So that is called IMSAS, Situational Awareness System, to the chief of the naval staff, right, which is, and second is the Astra MK1 missile to the Air Chief Marshal or to the Air Force, and Border Surveillance System to the chief of Army staff. So these three, which is indigenously developed, which is developed by Defense Research and Development Organization, DRDO, the Maritime Situational Awareness System to the Navy, and Astra MK1 missile to the Air Force, and Border Surveillance System to the chief of Army staff to surveillance the border. Okay. Now, what is this all about when we talk about, this system is all about? So you see, basically, IMSAS, first you understand this IMSAS, this is Indian Maritime Situational Awareness System. So it is basically, intelligence software system that provide a global maritime situational picture. Okay. For example, the Indian Navy used to collect lot of information from the maritime area, right? Lot of information have to be collected from the maritime area. Now, to collect that information, they have to venture in the maritime zone also, or in the oceans also. Now, they need to capture some of the pictures. So to capture those maritime situational pictures, this maritime planning tools, analytic capability to the Indian Navy is very, very important. Now, the Center of Artificial Intelligence and the Robotics, Bengaluru, and Indian Navy have jointly, conceptualized this project, which is also called IMSAS, right? So that the Navy can basically provide, or the Navy can capture the global maritime situational picture, which is the real-time picture, so that it can basically speed up the surveillance process all around this maritime zone. And it is basically the Bharat Electronics Limited, Bengaluru, which is basically implemented or produced this, basically, the project. The second is basically the BOSS, right? So BOSS is basically, is an all-weather electronic surveillance system, which is successfully designed and developed by the instrument research and development, you know, establishment Dehradun. So it is against and you know, a defense PSU which basically developed this BOSS, right? This system basically facilitated the monitoring and the surveillance of automatically detection of the institutions, right, in the harsh altitude sub-zero temperature areas with the remote operation capacity. So you can say that the border surveillance system, because in the border areas it will be very difficult, it will be very difficult to intercept those incoming vehicles or incoming, you know, the missiles which is coming now, to intercept them, right, at the high altitude. It is very difficult that something remotely operating capability should be enhanced so that they can basically intercept and alert the system if there is any sneaking through the border system. All right. So this is all about the DRDO system. Okay. So this is all about the news. Okay. So thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow with a new news. Okay. Thank you. Hello.